As the classic mythology would have it, vampires reproduce by turning their victims into other vampires. Revisionists and horror writers have played around with the idea of vampirism as a kind of viral infection, an STD transmitted from saliva to blood. Biologically, of course, there are some problems with this idea. If you create another vampire every time you feed, it won't be long before all your prey have been turned into vampires, all of which will get very hungry very fast. However, the idea isn't as totally absurd as it may seem on the surface. Lateral gene transmission is not unheard of in nature. Certain microbes are known to act as carriers for the DNA of other species, transmitting them from one host to another. And in any event, it appears that predator and prey share many of the same genes anyway in this case. Perhaps the only thing that needed to be transmitted was some kind of catalyst to activate them. More conventionally, vampires and humans never achieved complete reproductive isolation in any event. So there's no reason why interbreeding couldn't produce vampire offspring, especially if the critical vampire genes were heterozygously dominant. And let's not forget those aspects of vampire lore that are, without question, biologically and literally true. Their predatory habits, their speed and strength, their undeath, and their long lives. And of course, the crucifix glitch, which spelled the end of the vampire lineage. Although they obviously persisted long enough to embed themselves in our cultural mythology, the book is pretty much closed on the biological organism. Or is it? You'll recognize these figures, a Necker cube and a Rubens vase, popular examples of the so-called ambiguous illusion. Sometimes you see two faces, sometimes a vase. Sometimes the shaded panel seems to be behind, sometimes up front. Your perspective flips back and forth. You can see it one way, then another. Vampires can see it both ways at once. They don't have to flip back and forth. They can do something that's neurologically impossible for us. They can hold simultaneous multiple worldviews. This allows them to instantly grasp things that we find plagued by contradictions, to see things that we have to work out step by step. Take quantum physics. We humans have to be dragged kicking and screaming below the Planck length. We need complex math and numbers to force the truth onto us. And even then, the truth makes no sense. Nothing is real until someone observes it. Effect before cause, a cat in a box simultaneously dead and alive in some discorporeal state. The math forces us to accept a conclusion, but it violates everything we know about reality. But vampires understand quantum physics right down in the gut. It makes sense to them. Think of the ways we could benefit from such a creature. How many problems, political, environmental, even philosophical, intractable to the human mind, might prove trivially simple to a vampire? Not even computers offer such problem-solving potential, because no matter how many computers you network together, no matter how many quantum or classical elements you plug into it, you're still dealing with a machine that was ultimately designed by humans, and which therefore reflects the limitations and constraints of a human mindset. In contrast, we would not be designing vampires at all. Evolution has already done that for us. We would merely be bringing them back. Now, some might question whether vampires could ever fit into modern society. But remember that sociopaths are, in effect, fragments of vampire kind manifesting in human bodies. And sociopaths are among the most successful players in business, industry, and medicine. Ruthless pragmatism, lack of conscience, freedom from fuzzy, touchy-feely emotions like empathy. These are prerequisites of success in today's corporate environment. In fact, corporations themselves, as legal entities, meet all the diagnostic criteria for clinical sociopathy under the DSM-4. We know vampires could prosper in such an environment because, in a very significant way, they already do. The other question that arises is, even if they could solve all our problems, why would they? These are, after all, creatures that evolved to eat us, not to give us a hand with our homework. And certain alarmists from Greenpeace or the Sierra Legal Defense Fund have already begun to spread doomsday scenarios in which we bring back vampires and we'd have them wipe us out and eat us. And I'm the first to admit that you certainly wouldn't want to bring these creatures back without some kind of safeguards in place. But even here, the vampires prove to be our biggest ally, because vampires come with their own safeguards built right in. The crucifix glitch did them in once already, and it would kill them off even faster nowadays in our right-angle-filled urban environment. In fact, the only way we were able to keep them from going into convulsions at the drop of a hat, and I'm revealing a bit of a trade secret here, but we've already patented the molecule, so no harm done, was by keeping them on a strict regimen of what we call anti-Euclidean neurotropes. We have basically developed a drug that suppresses the seizures resulting from the crucifix glitch, and are already conducting preliminary marketing research to find an appropriate brand name. Now, this drug allows vampires to function normally in metropolitan settings, and without this drug, they will die. We have them on a very short and unbreakable leash, and they are more than intelligent enough to realize that serving our interests is in their best interest. Certain people who place emotion above intellect have called what happened to little Donnie Mass a crime. They are wrong. What happened to Donnie was only a tragedy, and it was a tragedy with a silver lining. The real crime would be if we let squeamishness prevail, if we turned our back on this opportunity to make the world a richer, better, and yes, even a safer place. Donnie would want us to push on, and it is for Donnie and for all the other children of the world that our first commercial batch of vampires is gestating even as we speak. We anticipate FDA approval within the month, and if that doesn't happen, a number of third world countries have already expressed interest in hosting our research in very favorable tax and regulatory environments. The potential benefits to mankind are incalculable, and with the proper safeguards in place, we can virtually guarantee that nothing will go wrong. Thank you.